Hello, and a very warm welcome to everyone joining us for this episode of Inspiring Inventors. Today, we're live on numerous social media platforms, reaching out to audiences all over the globe. Wherever in the world you are, and whichever platform you're on, we have another fantastic episode lined up for you today. This is the third episode in Inspiring Inventor series. Each one introduces an inventor, discusses the story behind their invention, and invites you, our audience, to interact with them in a Q&A session. So please remember to enter your questions to today's inventor as they occur to you. I'm Edward Cook. I'm a patent examiner at the European Patent Office, and I'm delighted today to be joined by our inspiring inventor, Dr. Carmen Hijosa, founder of Ananas Anam and inventor of Pinatex, a sustainable alternative to leather made from fibers of pineapple leaves. Before I introduce Carmen, let's have a look at a short film made for the European Inventor Award in which she was a finalist in 2021. The film describes her invention in a nutshell.
Retiring at 60? Absolutely not. This is when I started a new life. I filed a patent, I finished a PhD, and started a new company. Throughout my life, I worked in the leather luxury industry until I traveled to the developing countries and visited a leather tannery. And I thought, there must be something better behind a product. I decided there and then that I would stop working with leather. However, I didn't have a plan B. I decided to stop all. I remortgaged my house and I started a journey of 12 years of research and development. It was in the Philippines where I discovered weavers using these pineapple leaf fibers, which are the byproduct of the pineapple harvest. And then I thought, what if I make a new skein using these fibers? The pineapple fibers are then made into a non-woven mesh, and then they are moved to Spain when it is finished, which is then mass-produced and ready for the world market. Pinatex is one of the most sustainable materials in the market. It's saving natural resources and giving employment to people in developing countries. It's never too late to change your life for the better and for a sustainable future for all of us.
So, welcome, Carmen. How are you today?
Super well. Thank you, Edward. Hello, everybody.
Great. It's great to have you here. Thanks for taking the time out of your day today to join us. Now, that was a short video, but there is a wealth of information in it. You present, first of all, a very powerful, hopeful message about the potential for change and a more sustainable world. But what is also apparent to everyone, I think, is your strong belief in your idea. I mean, at 60, you secured a patent on your invention, you finished a PhD, and you started a business. And somewhere in that message, we also heard that you remortgaged your house. So you were quite busy. And I've heard you in another interview state something along the lines of, I'm going to do it and nothing is going to stop me. So my first question to you would be, how important do you think that kind of mentality is to get you to where you arrived today? So with a thriving business and a material that is sought after by global fashion brands.
You know, I think it is absolutely critical that you believe in your vision and your purpose. This is really what brings you beyond all the issues, the problems, confrontations, challenges. And I think this gives you inner strength as well. There is something about when you believe in something that is beyond yourself, you basically go through mountains, but you've got to have that inner depth to really think, this is important, not just for myself, but for something, in my case, for people and planet. I think this is very, very important.
Yeah, and with your invention, you can see because of the sustainable element to it, it's even more important in today's world. But would you also see that mentality is something that all entrepreneurs who want to be successful need to have some kind of way of fostering this belief in themselves?
Yes. Definitely. I think it is the first thing. Otherwise, as I said, it's really very hard to overcome the challenges. You know, an inventor an entrepreneur, usually you start either on your own or with very few people around you. So you really have to build yourself, build these surroundings to make sure that something happens. But for that, you have to have this total inner conviction, I think, that my goodness, nothing is going to stop me because I believe so strongly in what I'm doing. And to me, again, I think it's really important to think what it represents for others, because we have to project ourselves outside. Otherwise, we could be artists, you know, we could be just single designers, but no, entrepreneurs, we really put things out into the world. This is the whole difference.
Okay. I guess one thing that immediately strikes me about the journey that you went on is that, you know, often these journeys are started by what we would call a eureka moment, but yours seem to have started rather with the realization that you wanted to stop working in the leather industry due to its negative environmental impact. So can you tell us a bit about this realization that you wanted to do something more sustainable, more ecologically friendly?
Yeah, you are right. It wasn't a eureka moment. It was really an accumulation of little moments, but these particular little moments, they came about working in different parts of the world, which I think is really an eye-opening. I worked in South America with people like the Quechua Aymara indigenous communities in the altiplano, the second highest plateau in the world, having to help and work people in very dire circumstances, having very little facilities to do their work. It really showed me the importance that our work as creators, designers, inventors has on people, direct impact on people. So this was the beginning. I mean, if you think in the 90s, sustainability, this awareness we have today wasn't really there. I don't think we ever spoke about sustainability as such. So to me, it was the physicality and the absolutely heart awareness of how my work could actually have a very strong impact on people's lives. That is really, really important. And it is there today, in fact, just as much as before. And then I went to the Philippines and then I realized it's not just about people, it's about materials. Where do they come from? Where are they extracted? How are they made? And this nearly prepared me to realize that this material I had been working for 15 years really did not fit anymore into my way of thinking and way of wanting to live and to work and to produce something. And this is why I decided to stop, basically.
Okay, so your journey itself led you to the product that you have in the end. So, and I understand that you went to many places, but Philippines was where you actually saw these fibers being used, these fibers from pineapple leaves, to create, if I understood correctly, hand-woven clothes, which is probably an incredibly laborious task. Now, you invented a new way of using these fibers. But when you learned or saw that what they were doing in the hand-woven domain with these fibers from pineapple leaves, did it immediately occur to you that this might be something that you could work with as an alternative to leather, or was this something that only developed over time?
Both things, actually. I was very, very aware that I wanted an alternative to my material that I had before. So that was really the driver of this subconscious looking for things, right? And then when I started to look into these natural fibers, which is what I said to the people in the Philippines, let us look into what you have around you, natural fibers, natural, local skills, traditions. When I started to work with these ones, the pineapple leaf fibers, having been used, as you said, for these extraordinary, laborious and beautiful hand-woven textiles, I could see that because of their flexibility, their fineness, their possibilities to really be very strong as well, could be this, for me, the eureka moment is, what if I can make with these fibers a non-woven mesh? Basically what our skin is and the leather is actually a mesh of fibers interwoven all together. So that was really the eureka moment, but it was really working with them. In fact, I usually sorry, carry them with me because I make little bracelets. When they break, they just, these are the fibers. And you can see, well, they're a little, you know, they're very soft. They're as fine as a hair. So I wear it all the time. So this is how I work with things. You know, I become intimate with my materials, and they, I can nearly say they speak to you because they do, you know, there's this relationship that you say, ah, but then I can do something because of what they are. And this is actually my eureka, my creativity coming into action in a way.
Yeah, it looks, they look slightly more flexible than leather when they're in that fiber form, at least the way you showed it there, that you can roll it on and off your arm.
Yeah, because these have not been treated in any way, because if you, you know, then when they're done into this process, which is the felt-like, you can actually see that it becomes already much, much stronger again. Oh, sorry. There we go. Yeah, you can actually see a little bit of the fibers in there. But, you know, I mean, what we have inventors, as you know, we've got imagination, plenty of that. And then we work with that imagination. This is really the whole thing, to really see beyond what it is and see the potential. This is really the important thing.
So there, that's good, a good segue into what I wanted to ask you next. So you have seen this this potential within the fibers. So maybe at some point you have, like, you know, that sheet that you just showed us there, it's a proof of concept. You have a an idea that this might be suitable for an alternative to leather, and maybe you've gotten some positive feedback from your fashion industry contacts. But to be successful, you would have to scale this up, right? So to an industrial level. And we're talking about here a raw material that's for your invention, which is actually a waste product. At the end of the day, you simply can't go onto Amazon and click on pineapple leaf fibers and get them shipped to your house. So how much of a challenge was that for you? Because it, as you mentioned, you inventors have this vision, and that's often where it stops, because, you know, it's very difficult then to get it to go to the next thing, which is the mass production of your product. So how much of a challenge was that?
Oh, a huge challenge, because particularly at the time, I mean, Piñatex, the product we are talking about, it's the first plant-based material. It was the pioneer plant-based material in the market. So I would speak to people and would say, what's wrong with leather? What's wrong with my PVC, with my PU? So it was really a challenge, that, because it was too new. The concept was too new, right? So that was the biggest thing. Once you've got a little bit of something, like I would have had this tiny little bit, because I started nearly manually. Then you start to create this excitement with, let's say, people that they're in the market. And to me, it was actually the non-woven industry. So my breakthrough was really to go to, in the Philippines, to go to a non-woven factory and say, can you make this? And, you know, then this comes into the next phase of what we need to do, which is really collaborations, which is absolutely critical. You know, usually we can't do these things on our own. So when I said, can you help me to make this? Do you think this is possible? And this very wonderful man, Mr. Tan, said, Carmen, I think this would be very good for the Philippines and Filipino people. I'm going to help you. So this is what I got throughout the first processes. Even before I had a company, I was still doing my PhD. It was people seeing the potential from their side of the industry and saying, ah, this could be the future. I'm going to help you, which is wonderful, because without that, imagine you go into a factory, they've got machines that they can be 20 meters long and 5 meters, they look like nearly a house, you know. So they have to stop all that and start doing these trials that they have no idea, clean the machine. So they have to have a hope that there is something there. So it is up to us, with our vision, with our determination, to really show these future partners, but at the time they are basically just, you know, people like us, to say, ah, yes, this could be something in this. So I think it's key to bring collaboration into whatever you're doing, and really support your idea, obviously.
Yeah, and there we can see, I mean, I think you mentioned the two forms of collaboration. First, you had for the example of Mr. Tan there was going to help you, which are raw materials, get it going, get the products out. But then I guess you had to go to the fashion industry as well. And that it wasn't as easy as maybe it would be now. I mean, I'm thinking now if you go to the fashion industry and you have something which is sustainable, ecologically friendly, they're going to jump on it, right? But I guess when you went, was it like that? Was it so easy, or did you struggle to explain why anyone should move away from leather?
I knew something which I think is very important, because don't forget I come from, designing, manufacturing, selling my own product. And I knew that if I only presented this tiny little bit, nobody would believe me. But if I presented a roll of material, even if it was 20 meters, which is all I was able to do at the time, and prototypes made with it, people will really see it. So this is what I did. I actually developed the first manufacturing proof of concept, which was basically going through the whole machines and saying, we can make this. Even if it was a little bit primitive and rough, it didn't matter. The proof of concept is critical. And then that's not even enough. Then you really show, but Camper made a prototype, and Nike, or, they can make prototypes. Then people start, oh, then they see the product. So I think that was the other thing, to bring it into realization for the future buyers. And then another thing that really helped once that was done, because I knew I had to do that really, it's that at the time, it was really, in the 1915, more or less, when I finished, the vegan community was really dying to get something that wasn't plastic, because they were all really using plastic-based materials, and it was really getting stronger and stronger. So this was very, very important for us. So there was a really opening in the market there for us as well. And that was the beginning of really bringing the product into the market. And that was really critical.
Yeah, so yeah, timing is everything here. But then I have another question for you, and it would be if you obviously you didn't end up with something. You go, okay, this is the thing now that I can produce and put in the market. I guess there must have been at some point in your whole journey where you said, okay, I have something which is good enough. Maybe there are issues I need to resolve, but I'm gonna go to the market now. I'm gonna get it out there because now it's the time to do it. Is that something that arose on your path?
Absolutely. You really have to say, I stop now. I can't go on making it better and better. And I have to go into the market. You need that. You really need to present it. You need to get awareness. You really need to get clients. And with this awareness and potential in the market, then you need to get funding. You need to protect it. That's why we need to get into the patent thing, because it's really very critical as well. That is very important.
Yeah, and you kept yourself busy there because you also somewhere along the line you were getting your PhD, you were working on your research, on your academic part, and then you had to find out about patents and how to protect your invention. So where did that all come in? Did you get someone to do that for you, or did you do the research yourself to figure out what you had to do?
No, I did most of it myself, and you're absolutely right. It's another language. It's another way of thinking. It's to file a patent, it's quite a complex thing. But I was doing my PhD in the Royal College of Art and Design, so a hub for creativity. So we were very much made aware of the potential of our ideas, which is our IP. Is this intangible values, because as creators, sometimes our head doesn't stop thinking. But then, we don't really, I think a lot of us, we don't realize the value of our thinking until somebody says, oh, but that could be something important for this or the other. I became more and more aware as my product was getting more and more, people saying, oh, yeah, this could be used for this and the other. So I think the way I did it is, number one, talking to people in the college, which it would be for most people. Then obviously you Google. I didn't know about EPO at the time, so that wasn't it didn't come into my head. And then you really start talking to people. You've got patent agents and lawyers, and I started to look for one. And what I wanted to say is that that is something very critical to get the right one, because in fact, I went through three of them until I found the one that knew the language of my product, which is textile language, right? And I think this is really very important to really understand. I've got to get somebody that really understands my field, my research needs, and the language of my product. And I found it, and then we did it together, of course, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, it's a good point that you raised, because there has to be some initial education, I guess, from where you're based. So you had that from your university, and then you find out that you need to do research. And as you said, you looked on Google. I mean, DBO also has a free tool called a SpaceNet. But and I guess you used Google with your knowledge. So you knew, okay, look, I know no one else is doing this in this domain, but maybe there is something similar in another domain. So I search for non-woven fibers and I see what's there, and you get a whole lot of results back. Did you then have to go through those results, or did you go to your patent attorney with that stuff and say, look, I found this. Do you think this is relevant for what we want to protect?
I was very lucky that I was developing the supply chain as well. So, you know, the patent in this product is really the process and the final product. And because I had to develop the supply chain, because it didn't exist, I was very aware and I had an in-depth knowledge of my own product. So I could really go through and understand, okay, it's about non-wovens, it's about resins, it's about these things. So that gave me enough information to know that it wasn't quite there, but then I couldn't go any farther. You need a much more in-depth research and understanding, and then it's the writing, because the writing of a patent is not an easy thing, as you know very well. So then I needed help, and I think you know, it was the right thing to do.
Yeah, but that is, I would say, given my experience as an examiner, that is the ideal marriage. Someone who knows the product inside out, and then has a person who can write the protection required, but also with an understanding of what the invention is, that's vital. So I think you were really lucky to find a patent attorney who actually knew textiles. So that's good advice, I think, for people who are listening, if you can get someone like that.
I think it's critical. I agree with you.
Yeah. So then a couple of years after you filed your patent, I think it was 2013, you founded your company Ananas Anam to commercialize your product. And how important was having IP, be that patent protection or other forms of IP, in getting investors to provide funding for your company? I mean, I imagine you didn't have a mansion, so your remortgage was finished at this stage, I guess. Wasn't it?
No more. No, absolutely not. It was absolutely critical to have this protection. I mean, this is actually the IP of when I filed a company, I registered the company and an SNM. I had no assets whatsoever. So what you do, my only asset was really my patents. So to have the patents, and for me to have, you know, to file it at the time and have the patent, was really critical to get investors interested. And it is up to this day, because you know, as you know very well, expand the patent, you can bring it to different countries, you can really just, you know, you have different levels of this protection, and it is still really a very important part of the company assets. So I can say that absolutely critical to protect your invention.
Yeah, and I think in academia, yeah, in academia you have always this publish or perish thing as well, which is going on in the background. Yeah. So people feel like they need to, you know, how did you balance that? Because you if you're doing a PhD, I know myself, I did one, you have to publish papers. It's more than one, you know, you have to do a few, you have to attend conferences, you have to discuss what you're doing. How did you find that balance? Are you already focused enough to know, okay, I can't say X, Y, and Z now because I know where I'm going with this?
Well, don't forget that I was 60, or not quite 60, but, you know, I mean, I've got the value of my experience and wisdom, so I knew, and because this was not my first company as well. And I think people are more and more aware that you have to be very, very careful, you know, as you say, papers, because I come from the art and design background. It's not as it's not as important to publish papers, but what is important for us is to actually share and show our product at the end. And I knew I had to have it ready and finished my patent before I did my first presentation to anybody. So, you know, I was under huge pressure to do both things at the same time, but it was really, really important to have it done, definitely.
And you touched on this now. You mentioned that you've worked in different domains, in different geographic locations. You were in the Philippines. That's where you were doing your getting your raw materials and processing. And then you had probably another company somewhere else in Europe, maybe. So how did you decide where you were going to get IP protection? Was that something that was difficult because you have to balance in the cost of that as well? Yeah. So maybe your patent attorney helped you there, or you knew already yourself?
No, it was really both. And then my company was already there. So you know that you have to protect. In my case, it was the processes. So the Philippines was critical. Spain was critical because we're still finishing the product in Spain. And then your markets. You have to protect your markets as well. So where were we selling? So that was the first thing we looked into. Protect the processes, meaning production, and then the markets where we were selling the final product. So it was... It's kind of obvious once you know that, isn't it? You know that because it is super expensive, and as the market grows, you just have to start thinking, okay, if next year or in 2 years' time we're going to start selling in China, we have to protect it now before we sell there. And it is that kind of expansion of the patent which becomes pretty much a big portfolio, actually, to make sure that you're protected as your business grows and expands.
Yeah, and other forms of IP, like not just patents, did you also then have to worry about trademarks, designs, yeah, things like this? Yeah.
Okay. Absolutely. Particularly the trademarks. I mean, the names are critical. And in fact, you have to protect names. We already had a few people, you know, infringing quite closely. I mean, yeah, in the name. So trademarks is something that every time we make a new product, the first thing we do, we actually trademark the name, definitely.
Yeah, that's the price of success, Carmen, if people want to copy you.
I know. it's true.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I mean, listening to you talk about your product, I can understand that there's more to this than just IP protection. I mean, you're helping to clean up the fashion industry. I also understand that you're working with the biggest Filipino pineapple growing cooperatives, which comprise some 700 families who benefit from an additional income in return for supplying you with the raw materials that you need. So would you say that your invention is also about a sustainable communities as well as just as products?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. The purpose of the company, which I wrote already 10 years ago, is to heal the relationship between people and planet, meaning that the planet is where our product comes from. We don't really use any land or any water, fertilizers, because we are really a waste. And then it's people. I mean, people, as I was telling you, from the time I went to work in Bolivia, which was like my eye opener. To me, people, there is people behind any single thing that we touch and we do. And this awareness is, to me, the most important part of nearly my product, Piñatex. The responsibility we have towards people. People that otherwise, if they didn't work with us, they wouldn't have the opportunities, because we work with some of the poorest communities in some of the poorest parts of this, you know, subtropic part of the world, which is where the pineapples grow. And once you understand that and you are aware of this and you are with them, you work for them. I mean, to me, this is my drive. You know, this is really what keeps me pushing, is mainly our responsibility towards people's lives. Yeah.
Well, in today's climate, and the more we hear about what we're doing to the planet, these kind of your kind of work, your products, they become more and more valuable, I think, to humanity. So you touched there on what drives you, and what are your next steps, or what do you feel you have still to do as an entrepreneur or inventor or designer, maybe even what would you like to see in the future?
Well, our next stage as an entrepreneur, as our company grows, we are upscaling the supply chain, which is critical as well. And we are really trying to basically develop pilot centers, to call them something, in the different parts of the world, in the Philippines. At the moment, we're still making the first stage of the product, and we don't have finishing there, so we bring it to Spain, but we are actually developing the full process in the Philippines for the Asian market. We have a plant now, a small plant in Spain, and we will develop that plant for the European market. And as we move towards the other part of the world, which will be the Americas, particularly South America, places like Costa Rica, we will develop, the supply chain there. So the upscaling of the supply chain geographically is really the next stage, which we're already engaged. And as an inventor, you must know this, we don't stop thinking. We don't stop thinking that the product has to get better. We need new collections. We need, as the market opens, we are now working with the automotive industry. This is like a new product that has to perform so much more, more stringent tests, etc. And the product keeps flowing all the time. And as a designer, I wrote quite a long time ago that design is a connecting tool between people, the environment, and economics. And it's this communion between all these that really makes the world a better place. It really makes changes. So it has to be this holistic way of creating products that I think, to me, is very, very critical. So everything is kind of going all at the same time. You juggle all the balls kind of at the same time.
Yeah, you seem to be a bit of a professional at this, Carmen. That's the impression I get. And if we look at sustainability in your field, in fashion, for example, what do you see as the next big thing? Not only for yourself, but maybe other things happening on that you're going and looking at and going, wow, that's really interesting.
I think the interesting thing is that the big companies, multinationals, are really being and becoming very aware of what the world needs and the pressure that they have from us as consumers, right? I mean, everybody's looking for more transparency, which is fantastic, is what we need to do. Everybody is looking for really understanding the products and what is the supply chains and really the... We are a B Corp, which means that we are really not only responsible to our, if you like, investors, but to everybody in the supply chain. And this is what is happening more and more. And the interesting thing is that some of these big companies, obviously they cannot change overnight, and we work with some of these big companies. So in a way, it's a very nice and very positive symbiotic relationship that we have, because we can bring changes, we can really lead a little bit in these very complex changes that these big companies in the fashion industry can have, and help them really to bring about changes, even if they start in a tiny collection, a capsule collection. And I think this awareness, if this willingness to look into the responsibility that we all have, it's there. I can see it. Yeah, it might be a bit slow, but it is there. And I think this is really important and positive.
Yeah, I mean, as you mentioned, it comes from the consumers more often nowadays as well. We look at what the product is made from, where it's coming from, whether we're happy buying it or not. So and big enterprise obviously feel that.
Yeah.
So, changing slightly, I just wanted to say that you're the first woman inventor that we have had on the Inspiring Inventor series. So there have been various studies shown recently that women account for only between 10-15% of all the inventors listed on patent applications. Indeed, there was a short paper in Intellectual Asset magazine last month on this topic, and there have been other studies by the USPTO, by the World Intellectual Property Organization, and the EPO will publish its own study next month. So depending on the technology type, women might be more present amongst the inventors, but still a long way to go to get parity with men. So in your opinion, Carmen, what should be the key changes that we make to see more women named as inventors on patent application? Is there anything we can do there?
Well, yes, we can do. We can start in the family. I mean, if we think worldwide, as women, girls, We have the same capacity to really do anything that a man has, apart from maybe chopping wood or anything like that. You don't need to have a patent on that. What I'm trying to say is that it is really education. It is absolutely critical from primary school, from family to primary school, secondary school, because I think what we need a lot, and I have experienced that myself, it's this encouragement, it's this thinking, well, if that lady talking in there can do it, I can do it as well. I think, you know, to have more role models, inspiration, and be a little bit pushed, you know, but cushioned as well, and saying, of course you can do it. You can do it. You're just as good as your brother. Let's go. If you have a dream to become something, go ahead and do it. And I think, frankly, this is the way I can see it. But you can see there is still, I know this very little, but I give a lot of talks and conferences, and it's part of my role and part of my responsibility to make sure that I can inspire others. And I think this is a very important thing. We need role models, and the more the better. And I think it will get better. I can guarantee you this. I can see it.
Yeah, good. I hope so. I mean, I have two daughters
Me
and I have
too.
Five sisters, so I know the power of women all too well. So I don't see why they can't be more prevalent in inventing stuff. I think, as you say, it's a need for a change in understanding and attitude. And with people like you, Carmen, there with positive role models, I think we can definitely change those disappointing statistics. So before we open the discussion to the audience on social media and Slido, I have one last question for you, a very general question, and it would be, given your journey, is there any advice that you would offer today's budding young inventors, that maybe advice that you wished you'd gotten when you started out?
I think, number one, you really have to trust, particularly when we talk about women, trust that if you have an idea, something like this, please pursue it. Be confident to speak about it, think about it, write about it, research it, and, you know, work on it as a project of, is this going to go someplace? Is this only an idea? So expand your knowledge and imagination and the practicality of, you know, write it, make it into a project, and then share this with people that you know well. Be careful with who you share it, obviously. But I think it is an active role that this is. You really cannot just sit there and think, oh, that sounds great. No, it's a very active, positive, active, but a little bit, I wouldn't like to say aggressive, but I hope you understand what I mean. You really have to get out there and push your way forward and say, hey, I've got something. This is the plan. This is what I think. What do you think? If there's somebody that you can trust, but push yourself. I think it's absolutely critical, and believe in that idea until it's proven that you cannot go any farther. But it is that way, I think, you know, you've got to push it.
Yeah, I mean, I noticed from some videos I saw of you that you didn't wait for perfection. You said, okay, I'm ready to go now, so I'm going to go, I'm going to do this. So that's something you would also encourage inventors to mimic this.
I think that is absolutely critical. Otherwise, we hold on to our little babies and we don't do anything with them. We just say, oh, it's not ready. No. It gets to be, at one point, you have to let go and say, move, because otherwise I would be still doing trials, and we can't do that, you know. We have to, and this is a little bit of bravery as well, and saying, I must let go and share, because once you let go, it's like, you know, our children, then you really have to say, okay, let's see how it can move into the world. I think it's really important to do that, yeah.
Okay, let's have a look. I will go now to our Slido, the questions, and see what. Okay, so we have quite a few questions here. The first one, which has got quite a number of likes, is, did Carmen explore other materials as an alternative to leather before using pineapple leaves?
Yes, I did. I explore other natural fibers. Obviously, I was in the Philippines, so I looked at banana fiber, abaca, which is another kind of banana, pineapple as well. But to me, as I show you my bracelet, I was looking for something really particular, which was fineness, strength, but flexibility, and these were the fibers. But you know, you really, I mean, it's like writing a patent, isn't it? You've got a big umbrella there and you've got so many different possibilities, and then you narrow it down to the one that is absolutely right for you. So definitely I did go into others. Yeah.
Okay, and another one we have here is, in which sectors is the invention used currently? So I guess we have the fashion section, but then you mentioned automobiles, you mentioned maybe you're going to use it for other things as well.
Yes, our biggest market at the moment is the shoe market. So shoes, they love my product, and then accessories, bags as well, and then a little bit of apparel, but that is all related to the fashion market. And then we're starting to break into the interior market. We did some interesting work for some hotels, restaurants, etc. And the automotive is the one that is now coming on, indeed, yes. As I said a little bit, the automotive industries are really very stringent. It goes through so many different tests, so it can take up to 3 to 4 years to develop. So we are in the process of developing our materials for the automotive industry, yes. And then eventually we can do it in other, you know, more industrialized. Think about filters, think about insulation, think about many things. But hey, step at a time. Yeah.
Yeah, insulation is a good one. I never thought of that, but it does lend itself to that as well. Yeah.
Particularly sound as well. Vitally, filters. Yeah.
Sound. Okay.
Sound is a good one too. Mm.
So we have another question here, which has been liked a lot. Who or what had the greatest influence on your journey as an inventor?
You know, I wasn't influenced by other inventors because I didn't know any in my field. This is the truth. And I wasn't really working in a team in university, you know, in science, etc. I think the biggest influence on the journey as an inventor, it was still nature for me. I mean, think of biomimicry, think of how, as I said before, I work very intimately with nature. It's nearly that I have a dialogue with nature in a very profound way. So nature was probably one of the biggest influence because I work with it, I feel it, I feel my fibers. They do speak to me and I speak to them. So I think nature is, and then how I work with people, particularly the responsibility that this kind of invention has on people's lives, that is also a very important part, indirectly to an invention, but nevertheless is part of as well.
Yeah, it sounds, listening to you, it sounds like it's a motivation for you to succeed. It seems to push you forward as well, this responsibility that you feel to people. So that's another important point to make. So I have a question here. How did the fact of being nominated for the European Inventor Award impact your work or impact your company? Did it help in any way, or did it motivate you to, or just maybe just give you a pat on the back, tell you, look, you know what I did was worth doing?
Well, number one, as we were saying, as a woman, it gave me a huge pat in my back. It was absolutely wonderful. The pride to think that, my goodness, I'm up there with all these guys, most of them, with all these extraordinary inventors. So that was really, really important. As a company, it was also a huge worldwide recognition that, you know, we got to this high level of acknowledgement. That was really, really very important as well. And obviously in the marketplace, with all the publicity and everything we got, we were still getting, you know, it was very, very important as well. So in every sense, it was quite an honor and extraordinary good for my company and myself as well.
That's good to hear that it has a positive impact on people's lives. Okay, let's go back. Yeah, so here's a question about eco materials, which obviously your invention is. What do you think would be the next big step in eco materials? Do you see, say, you took plant-based materials to make something. Do you see that as something that can move into other domains as well? So not just like leather, for example, but other roles.
There are more and more plant-based, which I think I would call plant-based materials, the eco-materials. I'm not talking about minerals or metals or anything. I'm talking really about plant-based particularly, because what we have today, which we really need to do, is to use better our resources, to use resources that particularly come from waste. I think this is so important. And I think an important thing in this is the, which is still not there, but we are getting closer, the conglomeration or the really unification of all these new materials into a more of a, you know, think of the Leather Association. It's a very powerful lobby, strong for many things and helps everybody, right? And I think to me it will be quite important, and we're actively working on making sure that there is a strong voice, that there is a strong acknowledgement and potential as a group of alternative materials, not just Piñatex, not just another materials, but together, that we can make this change and this shift in the material world. Obviously material world in my case is particularly in the textile world. Yeah, that's why I'm saying textiles, leather textiles, but that kind of world, using materials that they have not maybe been used industrially before. We are really working on that as well, to reduce the use of things like so much cotton, because cotton uses so many pesticides, as we know, so much water. It's really, you know, we just have to have alternatives. So the alternatives are there in these more ancient fibers, fibers that have not been maybe used as much industrially. And I think this compilation and awareness and help to bring them out there, it's going to be very, very important, actually, to bring these eco materials into more of a prominent place in the marketplace. Yeah.
Okay, that's very interesting to hear. I mean, I think it's good that people understand that cotton is, although I would have always understood it as being a very natural material, then has disadvantages associated with it, with the past, that's not so blatantly obvious to me. So it's good to have people who understand that and know that then we have to look for alternatives because of those factors.
Yeah, absolutely. We do, really. And it's up to us to do that as well.
So this question goes back to the patenting process. And the question is, how did the patenting process fit into your journey towards the mass production of your invention? So you mentioned that you patented the process itself, but then I guess there are other things to consider in mass production, such as where you set up your company, maybe what machines you need to be able to do mass production. So maybe you can enlighten us a bit on that.
The patenting process, it was more on the process. It wasn't really on the machines, but nevertheless, to have this mass production, you really need to develop systems. I mean, there are really systems and processes which have to be protected in a way. Be very aware of who is your partners, how do you protect all this knowledge, how do you share the knowledge. So the legal side, when you go into mass production, to have joint development agreements is absolutely critical. Yes, I think so. Sorry, may I say that I'm running low of battery and I would not like to be leaving you behind. Would you mind to either give me 2 seconds, or if you think that we are going to finish in 3 minutes, it might be there. I'm a little bit worried that...
What do you need? You just need to plug something in, do you? Well, I think we've...
I think I better, because this is a new place for me. Let's continue. Hopefully I won't be cut off from battery.
Maybe we can do one more question and then we can stop, Carmen, because we've done taken a lot of your time and we've asked a lot of questions. So let's have a look and see what's there. I think there's a really interesting question which I saw, which was about artificial intelligence. It sort of piques my interest. We use artificial intelligence a lot to do things like identifying new drugs or reuse drugs, for example. We see that like a drug was used for one thing and artificial intelligence identifies that this drug could be used for something else because it has particular properties. Now, do you see a role for artificial intelligence in identifying eco materials? It seems something like a domain it could work in, no? Or not?
I never gave it a thought because, the way we work with natural materials is so close to the land and so close to the people. It's not something that happens in a lab. I mean, there are some materials that are more lab-based materials, and then I think that might be really a bit more. But interesting question. I don't really have a straight answer for that one. I think as we grow the systems, the way we really develop systems to understand, for example, qualities in different parts of the world, etc., that might be something it could be used. But I don't have an answer, a clear answer. I'm sorry.
No, I just thought it was a really interesting question because it's not something that immediately occurred to me to use artificial intelligence. So I thought it was a good
No.
question. Okay, I don't know. So if you want to, do you want to plug something in, or do you want to say we've addressed enough now?
I think I can see that I don't have in here right with me the actual plug because I left it with my phone. As I said, I'm sorry, I'm not in my own
Okay.
place.
No, that's no
So we
problem.
can.
We can maybe before we lose you, we can close the conversation. If you're ashamed to close it when you're not here, so it was a pleasure talking to you, Carmen. It was really nice conversation. Thank you so much for taking time out of your day to
Thank
join us,
you.
and we wish you all the best in all your future endeavors, whatever they may be. I look forward to seeing being a text in my car in 10 years' time.
Yes, oh no, not much before that. You will see it
Much
before
before
that, I
that. Okay, that's
hope.
good.
Definitely. Thank you so much. Thank you. It's been my pleasure as well. Definitely.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Then I would also now like to take the opportunity to thank our audience for their great questions. You've all been really great and helped make this a really interesting talk. The next episode of Inspiring Inventors will be in December, where we will be in conversation with the Dutch inventor Jan van der Tempel, who will talk to us about his invention, which is in the domain of safe transport to and from offshore platforms. So please check out the Inspiring Inventors page on the EBO website for further details on this. And that's it then. Until the next time we meet, I want to wish you a great evening and thank you very much for being here with us.